You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Hi everyone, this is JJ, the co-founder of Good Pods. If you haven't heard of it yet, Good Pods is like Goodreads or Instagram, but for podcasts. It's new, it's social, it's different, and it's growing really fast. There are more than 2 million podcasts, and we know that it is impossible to figure out what to listen to. On Good Pods, you follow your friends and podcasters to see what they like. That is the number one way to discover new shows and episodes. You can find Good Pods on the web or download the app. Happy listening.
In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the healthcare coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a mutual legal reserve company. In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the healthcare coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a mutual legal reserve company.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
Not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand.
Welcome into the Monday edition of the Rick Robinson Show. That's right. For those of you working for the weekend, we already made it through one. Now we're trying to climb the hill towards the other one. And unfortunately, we're at the bottom of the hill. So for those of you who may have missed it, we did just do, within the last half hour or so, we concluded live coverage of Oklahoma State of the State Address with Governor Kevin Stitt. It's his sixth time behind the microphone. Two more left after this one. So anyway... Fun times. So many fun times. Lots of good meat in there, especially for Oklahomans. I do like the fact that he is trying to completely get away from state income tax, because taxation is theft. I also like the fact that he compared and contrasted, you know, Florida, who has no state income tax, to New York, who has quite a lot of state income tax, and how much different their budgets are. And this is something that I have tried to explain to people for a very, very long time. It's not about how much tax revenue you bring in. It's about how much money you're sending out. And unfortunately, that brings us to the other monstrosity that's happening at the federal level. We heard for weeks, it's not as bad as you think. It's not as bad as you think. It's not as bad as you think. You know why they kept saying it's not as bad as you think? Because it was worse. I spent all night poring over this stupid Senate bill that is nothing but, and I put out a tweet about it this morning. For those of you trying to make sense of where we are with this bill, let me just sum it up for you as quickly as I can before we do a little bit of a deep dive on it. This is basically the Democrats' version of Wonka's golden ticket, because it gives them absolutely everything they want and absolutely nothing that they don't. And the funny thing is, you hear, well, it sets a hard limit to where the president has to close the border. Our border's already supposed to be closed. There's a law in the books that makes it a felony to come into the country illegally. Do you see our president enforcing that law? Do you really think that more laws are going to make it that? Do you really think he's going to follow those either? And the scariest thing about this is, and I keep trying to explain this to people, ladies and gentlemen, this isn't about fixing our border. This is about making you understand that we need new people coming in here, and it doesn't matter how they get here, because the Democrats are losing their voter base. And they have been for a long time. I played some audio on Rails last night, and we may play it again tonight, or today, of a woman of color basically coming ungrooved in front of a bunch of cameras and telling everybody, look, man, we are starting to understand the truth. And in her case, it seems like she's always known it, so maybe she's always been one of the supposed rare black Republicans, but I think there are a lot more of them than any of them want to admit, because as soon as you leave the plantation, all of a sudden you're Uncle Tom. But again, there's scary, scary things about this bill. So this is division. We're just going to kind of start going over it here. Going to get after it and start going over it was what I was trying to say, and it didn't work. So this is Division C of the Border Act, Title I, Capacity Building, Subtitle A, Hiring, Training, and Systems Modernization, Chapter 1, Hiring Authority, Section 3101, USCIS, Direct Hire Authority. A grants direct hire authority for positions within the Refugee Asylum and International Operations Directorate or the USCIS Service Center Operations Directorate for which public notice has been given. The Secretary has determined that a critical hiring need exists, and the Secretary has consulted with the OPM Director regarding the position for which the Secretary plans to recruit. The quantity of candidates the Secretary is seeking, and the assessment and selection policies the Secretary plans to utilize. B, it also defines critical hiring need as personnel necessary for the implementation of the Act and associated work. Anybody starting to figure out this is going to grow government exponentially just from those two little entries? Requires 5 annual reports to Congress, which include demographic data, including veteran status. You heard what I said there. Salary information and individuals hired under the authority and how DHS exercised authority consistent with the merit system principles. Section D, authority sunsets after 5 years. Section 3102, ICE direct hire authority. Grants direct hire authority for positions within enforcement and removal operations as a deportation officer or with duties exclusively relating to the enforcement and removal of custody operations, alternatives to detention or transportation and removal program for which public notice has been given. The Secretary has determined that a critical hiring need exists, and the Secretary has consulted with the OPM Director regarding the positions for which the Secretary plans to recruit, the quantity of candidates the Secretary is seeking, and the assessment and selection policies the Secretary plans to utilize. Section B, critical hiring need is defined as personnel necessary for the implementation of the Act and associated work. Again, requires 5 annual reports to Congress, which include demographic data, including veteran status, salary information of individuals hired under the authority, and how DHS exercised authority consistent with the merit system principles. Again, this authority sunsets after 5 years. Section 3103, reimplementation of civilian retirees to meet exceptional employment needs. With respect to any position in Immigration and Customs Enforcement or the Refugee Asylum and International Operations Directorate, the Field Operations Directorate, or the USCIS Service Center Operations, the DHS Secretary, in consultation with the OPM Director, may waive on a case-by-case basis the application of the section of code governing the reduction, suspension, or termination of annuity payments for reemployed annuitants for the employment of an annotated hire to a position necessary to implement the Act and associated work, and for which there is exceptional difficulty in recruiting or retaining a qualified employee, or when a temporary emergency hiring need exists. Section B, the DHS Secretary, in consultation with the OPM Directorate, shall prescribe procedures for the exercises of the authority, including for the delegation of authority. C, an employee for whom a waiver under this section is in effect shall not be considered an employee for the purposes of CSRS or FERS. Section 3104, establishment of a special pay rate for asylum officers. At grades 1 through 15, the general schedule, the special base rate for an asylum officer shall be derived by increasing the otherwise applicable general schedule base rate for the asylum officers by 15% for the grade of the asylum officer, rounded to the nearest whole dollar. B, clerical amendment. The special pay rate is effective the first day of the first applicable pay period beginning 30 days after the enactment of the Act. Can you tell these things are written by attorneys? I'm just saying. Chapter 2, hiring waivers. Yeah, this is just going. Let's keep going. See what else we can find here. So, modernization of notices to appear. This is another one that got my attention earlier. electronic notices to appear. Gives DHS the authority to serve notices to appear in immigration court electronically if the alien elects to receive such notices electronically. Section 3132, authority to prepare and issue notices to appear. Didn't they already have this? Gives authority to Border Patrol processing coordinators and other mission support personnel to issue notices to appear to aliens in CBP, ICE, or DHS custody. This allows for Border Patrol agents and ICE officers to stop processing paperwork and return to their border security and interior enforcement missions. That part actually kind of sounds good on the face of it, but it gets worse. Subtitle B, asylum processing at the border. This subtitle establishes the provisional removal proceedings under Section 235B, Protection Merits Removal Proceedings under 240D, and Procedures for Voluntary Departure, Section 240E, Withdrawal of Applications, Section 240F, and Voluntary Repatriation, 240G. These provisions create a mechanism where an alien who is encountered at the border and placed in these proceedings will receive a credible fear interview under the elevated status within 90 days of crossing the border and will have their case decided on the merits within 180 days of crossing our border. Current law only allows the use of expedited removal for an alien that is detained. This provision creates a new non-custodial expedited removal authority to use when detention space is beyond capacity. Nothing in this bill changes the existing expedited removal authorities or the authorities needed to remain in Mexico. Under the new custodial expedited removal... Why does it even mention remain in Mexico? They got rid of that. Just saying. The alien is required to be enrolled in a mandatory alternatives to detention from the beginning of proceedings to removal. The new authority speaks to asylum screening at a higher standard and decreases the appeals and acceleration of departures or deportations. Same thing, really. Under current law, an alien encountered at the border is released from custody with a notice to appear that sets a date for the alien's first hearing 10 or more years in the future. Aliens are able to access work authorization while they wait that 10 or more years in the asylum backlog. Well, if we weren't letting them pour through the border, we wouldn't have such a backlog now, would we? This provision in this subtitle will end the asylum backlog and ensure that aliens whose claims do not have merit are deported weeks to months after crossing the border, not years, decades, or never. Except, as good as all this sounds on paper, this part actually sounds pretty good. It really does, because we're speeding up the process to figure out who is validly here, who has an actual claim to be here, and who should be sent back. Except again, do you really think they're going to listen to any of this? There are already laws on the books that addresses every single bit of this, and they're not following them. So you have to ask yourself, why is it that during an election year, I might add, all of a sudden this president is gung-ho on fixing the border? The border was fixed when he took office. Was it? Well, it was patched. It wasn't fixed. But the situation was well in hand when he took office. He undid all of it with pens over and over and over again, signing executive order after executive order that undid Trump-era immigration policies. Now he's screaming for Congress to give him the power to fix it, when in reality, the power is already there. Again, I hate to remind you guys of this, but it is already a felony to come into this country illegally. But I've been saying this for as long as I've been doing this type of work. As soon as we stop enforcing one law, it will only be a matter of time until all laws become unenforceable. And we're seeing that happen now, everywhere. You can't enforce shoplifting laws anymore because they're changing the limits. You can't hold people accountable for beating the crap out of police officers, because all they get is a desk ticket and get released on their own recognizance. Half of those guys are in California now. So you think they're really coming back? And the police are like, well, we'll just issue a warrant. Good luck. California is a sanctuary state. So are you. I'll be surprised if your warrant actually gets approved. But this, I mean, it's going to take days for us to go over all of this. I'm just trying to show you the depth, the breadth, and the scope of this thing, because it's going to create hundreds of thousands of new positions that are going to require hundreds and thousands, if not millions, of dollars of funding. And it's all designed to make us feel better because, oh my God, they're finally going to start doing something about the border. If they really wanted to do something about the border, they could do it now. But they don't because they don't care. And guys, just being completely honest, we need to stop laying this at the feet of one party or the other. Both parties want this for different reasons. And that's the truth of it. The Democrats are concerned that more and more of the people of color that have been their voting base for a very, very long time, other than suburban white women, I said what I said, are starting to wake up to the fact that none of their policies for the hundred years or nearly 100 years that they've been enacting them for them. I mean, you have to remember, Civil Rights Act passed in the 60s. This is 2024. It only took four generations for them to go, oh, maybe these people aren't as much help as we thought they were going to be. And yet, here we are, dealing with these same issues over and over and over again. All right, we're going to take a break. I know that segment was a little bit long, but I need to get a drink because I've already been doing this for an hour and a half today. Got another hour and a half-ish to go. Anyway, let's see. What were we going to go to break with? I had something in mind. Oh, that's what it was. All right. Fired up some stuff from the Wayback Machine. You guys may recognize this one. You may not. All right. I'm Rick Robinson. This is my show. We are live on KLRN Radio, where we do this thing every Monday through Friday from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern. It's time for a break. Get up, stretch your legs, grab a drink, whatever you got to do. We'll be back in about 5-ish. Stay tuned.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Hi everyone, this is JJ, the co-founder of Good Pods. If you haven't heard of it yet, Good Pods is like Goodreads or Instagram, but for podcasts. It's new, it's social, it's different, and it's growing really fast. There are more than 2 million podcasts, and we know that it is impossible to figure out what to listen to. On Good Pods, you follow your friends and podcasters to see what they like. That is the number one way to discover new shows and episodes. You can find Good Pods on the web or download the app. Happy listening.
In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on.
Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the health care coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a Mutual Legal Reserve Company. In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the healthcare coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a Mutual Legal Reserve Company.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 of pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
Into the program, ladies and gentlemen. Again, I am Rick Robinson. This is the Rick Robinson Show, live right here on KLRNradio.com. Hope everybody's having a great Monday. I know some of you are distraught and sad that it's Monday again, but for those of you working for the weekend, it's only a few days away. Just It's all right. Anyway, so to get back to the show, a bit of semi-breaking news. Apparently this happened while I was covering the State of the State address. So,
take you back to a moment, 2001.
I can hear you! I can hear you, the rest of the world hears you, and the people... We'll hear all of us soon.
All right, so that was one of President George W. Bush's most iconic moments. And for those of you who remember that speech, there was a New York City firefighter standing next to him during that entire exchange under was Bob Beckwith, New York City firefighter who stood at President George W. Bush's side at Ground Zero in the immediate aftermath of the 2001 terror attacks, unfortunately has passed away.
Here with reaction, former acting defense.
It moved on me, and I didn't tell it to do that, so I apologize. I had everything paused, so I thought it was done. So unfortunately, he has passed away. Former President Bush addressed Beckwith's passings in a statement on Monday where he said the following: Laura and I are saddened by the passing of Bob Beckwith on September 11, 2001. Bob was happily retired after more than 30 years of service with the New York City Fire Department. When the terrorist attacked, Bob suited back up. And like so many brave first responders, raced towards the danger. Sorry. I've not been in anything like 9/11, but I have been in similar situations. So I do understand that man's driving force and why he did what he did. I will say that luckily he had a long and, from all reports, a fairly happy life. I guess he passed away at the age of 91. I only hope I get to live that long. But then again, I've been outliving the odds since I was born. I was told by my parents I'd be lucky if I lived 2 months in the incubator. And then it was, well, he'll be lucky to see 14. And it's, well, he'll be lucky to see 18. And so I live my life as if every day could be my last for the longest time, because I kept being told that every day basically was my last. And now I'm 50 years old and have very little to show for it. I'm trying to fix that. So, all I can say is, you've earned your rest, my friend. You did everything you could do and more. Alright, let's see if I can turn the waterworks off here. Anyway, so that was a bit of a breaking story that came out. I guess it's been out now for, since about 11:30 this morning. So I guess it started becoming news when I was getting ready to start doing everything, and somehow I missed it, so it kind of felt like we needed to talk about that. Now back to the monster at hand. This stupid border bill. This stupid border bill. I swear to God. So our very own Andrew actually did a lot of work on this yesterday. Didn't realize it at the time, but we were basically kind of duplicating each other's work, kind of pouring through this monstrosity. And I have discovered that our friend who likes to claim he's really only good at things like fart noises is actually really, really good at research. So he may get extra gigs soon. Just kidding, Andrew. I know you're listening. Don't panic. So I kind of want to go over this stuff because I didn't really have much time to do it yesterday. So this is Andrew's take after being in 3 pages worth of the bill. So this is Title I, Department of Defense, military personnel for the Army. For an additional amount for military personnel, Army, 207, how much is that? $207,158,000 to remain available until December 31st, 2024 to respond to the situation in Ukraine and for related expenses provided. that such amount is designated by the Congress as being for an emergency requirement pursuant to Section 251B, Subsection 2, Subsection A, Subsection I of the Balanced Budget and Emergency Deficit Control Act of 1985. Anybody catch that? We already have a Balanced Budget Act. Anybody wonder why we're not following that anymore either? These are the same people that, if you pass this, we're going to follow it. So, military personnel for Marine Corps. For an additional amount for the military personnel Marine Corps, $3,538,000 to remain available until December 31st, 2024, to respond to the situation in Ukraine and for related expenses, provided that such amount is designated by the Congress as being for an emergency. Again, according to the same budget, Balance Budget and Emergency Deficit Control Act of 1985. Now, keep in mind, I was like 12 in 1985, so I had no idea about any of this. I mean, at 12, who the hell's thinking about politics at 12? But this just shows you how long they've been flagrantly doing whatever the hell they want. I'm actually going to have to look at that and see exactly what that law entails, because I'm curious now, because I didn't even know we had that, because everybody keeps talking, we need to pass a balanced budget amendment. Kind of sounds like we did in 1985. It just sounds like nobody's following it anymore. So, military personnel, or Air Force, for an additional amount for military personnel, Air Force, $23,302,000 to remain available until December 31st, 2024, to respond to the situation in Ukraine and for related expenses. Provided that such amount is designated by the Congress and is being for an emergency requirement pursuant to Section 251, Subsection B, Subsection 2, Subsection A, Subsection I of the Balanced Budget and Emergency Deficit Control Act of 1985. Military Personnel Space Force. Sorry. For an additional amount for Military Personnel Space Force, $4,192,000 to remain available until December, blah, 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 blah. You guys already know that stuff. Not going to keep reading it. Operation and maintenance. Operation and maintenance for Army. For an additional amount of operation and maintenance, Army, $4,087,000 to remain. Yeah, I didn't notice the extra comma at first either. $4,887,581,000 to remain available until December 31st, 2024. So if this bill passes, they're basically giving the military a shopping spree of nearly $5 billion to do basically whatever they want. But of course, it's supposed to be for Ukraine, and subject to all those other things that we were talking about a moment ago. Now, keep in mind, this is only on, like, page 3 and page 4 of this 380-page bill. What, 380, 370, something like that, I don't remember. So, page 5, they're still spending for Ukraine. Page 6, last of the individual services. Page 6 at the bottom, operation and maintenance defense-wide set a large pot for more money. Big surprise. Again, I just want to read you these totals. For an additional amount for operational and maintenance defense-wide, $34,230,780,000. Where the hell are we getting this money from? We don't have it. I know it's, you know, it's in bad form to put the dead clock up when a Democrat is in office, but it's $37 trillion in debt right now. I'm just saying. So on page 7, much more of the same, noting different amounts being available until September 30th, 2025. This section also mentions Israel, Ukraine, and Taiwan, and according to Andrew, goes on for quite a while. And it does, because I've read through it. Page 9 starts the procurement section for the services. The Army is up first with missile procurement, with funds remaining available until September of 2026. And again, that is $2,742,737,000. But Rick, you have to understand those missiles are really expensive. Yes, which is why I wonder why we're using them all on drones and shit instead of dealing with their command and control structures. Oh, wait, did I say that out loud? My bad. Page 10, more money for the Army. Page 11, Navy, for weapons, shipbuilding, and two more submarines. Interesting. Page 12 is the end of the Navy procurement and starts the Marines procurement. Page 13, Air Force starts along with defense-wide procurement. Page 14, defense-wide procurement, which includes Israel's Iron Beam and Dome defense systems, with Ukraine having money too. Also starts Defense Production Act purchases. Page 15, the research, development, test, and evolution section, Army's up first. Yay, for an additional amount of research, development, test, and evaluation, the Army will receive $18,594,000 to remain available until September 30th, 2025, to respond to the situation in Ukraine and for related expenses. Again, provided all the stuff that we've gone about ad infinitum. Page 16, Navy and Air Force are up. Navy gets, what, $20,825,000. And then Air Force is $13,825,000. I think, hang on, no, that's not right. So of the $20 million, $13 million will be specifically to respond to the situation in Ukraine. Air Force, holy crap! I guess the Air Force really is the most favored service branch. Receives for development, test, and evolution $406,834,000. Yay. So, yeah, again, where are we getting all this money? Nobody seems to be able to tell me where this money's supposed to come from. So then we go into page 17, which covers defense-wide spending and the Inspector General spending. Page 18, Intelligence Community Management Account and General Provisions, which, again, just so you know, is more and more and more of the monies. Money for the DNI is on page 19. Page 24, Department of Energy is getting money. I mean, we should just do a bit with, like, the Oprah thing. And you get money. And you get money. And you get money. Everybody gets money. Because that's kind of what this is starting to feel like. Page 25, federal salaries and expenses are related to Ukraine and general provisions for the Nuclear Fuel Security Act. That we'll have to come back and look at later. Page 30, Department of Homeland Security, FEMA gets money to the amount of around $400 million. That make you feel better? Not really. Page 32, Department of Health and Human Services, $2.3 billion. More money, more money, more money, more money. More money, more money, more money. Hey. And the funny thing is, and I went over this last night, the reason Senator Langford can sit here and tell everybody, well, this isn't a cap on how many people we're going to allow in, is because it uses the word encounters. Because that means anytime they come into contact with them, whether they're trying to come to the border or not, does count. But here's the other thing that I found last night, and I was looking for it again, and I think I hit it for myself. There is a subsection of that area that talks about how the people that are not coming from contiguous continents will not be counted toward those overall thresholds. So it's all a shell game, folks. This is all a way to make Biden look like he finally did something about the border when he's the one that broke it in the first place. This is all a way for the Democrats to say, look, we're trying to fix it, the Republicans won't let us. What you guys need to understand is nothing about this bill is actually going to fix our border. Are some of the things in there needed? Quite possibly, but we don't need them to be cluttered up with all this other freaking golden ticket Willy Wonka bullshit. And that's the point that I've been trying to make for a very, very, very long time. This is a shell game. This is nothing but a grift. It has been for a long time. Both parties want immigration for different reasons. We talked about this some last night. We're going to go into it again before we go back to the top of the hour. So just to make sure we're on the same page, on a separate bill that is kind of tied to this thing, what they are trying to do is put together a path for both assimilation and citizenship by serving in our military. Not enough details are known about it yet to know exactly what the length of time would need to be for said service, etc., but this is part of what they're trying to do. And they are using, and I will pull this up again in a minute so you guys can hear it, they are using the excuse that... They are using the excuse that there aren't enough people currently trying to join our military, so they're trying to backfill the ranks, so to speak. And give me just a moment, and we will, that's that one, that's this one. All right. So
what troubles me about the debate now about the southern border is it is one half of the immigration equation. Yes, we need order at the border. Yes, we need to have changes in the laws that reflect the reality of the overwhelming numbers from all over the world who are coming to our shores and our border. But there's also an incredible demand for legal immigration into this country even now. The presiding officer, my colleague from the state of Illinois, has legislation which addresses one aspect of that. Her bill, and I hope I describe it accurately, says that if you're an undocumented person in this country and you can pass the physical and the required test, background test, the like, you can serve in our military, and if you do it honorably, we will make you citizens of the United States.
What the fuck?
Do we need that? Do you know what the recruiting numbers are at the Army and the Navy and the Air Force? They can't reach their quotas each month. They can't find enough people to join our military forces. And there are those who are undocumented who want the chance to serve and risk their lives for this country. Should we give them the chance?
What are you doing? What are you doing?
What troubles me about the debate now about the southern border is it is...
Sorry, I guess it was done. Sometimes I forget how short some of these clips are. But yeah, so there you have it. One of the bills being proposed right now is a path to citizenship for illegal aliens by having them serve in our military. Now, keep in mind, this is the part that I'm trying to make everybody understand. You are giving people access to military hardware and military training that have already committed a felony. Does this seem like good practice? I get it. They're desperate because nobody wants to join our military. I wonder why nobody wants to join our military, though. Because DEI is killing everything that it touches, including our military. You know, the funny thing is, and this is not something that I really planned on talking about today, but it's something that keeps coming up for me. And it's people that have traveled abroad that find out in all these places that we consider adversaries and we consider less than us and everything else. You know, the funny thing is, you know, Putin is not teaching his little boys to chop their pee-pees off. No. You know what they do? They start learning boxing as part of their education curriculum. Boxing. You know what else they do? Before they ever set foot in a ring, they learn all of the basics, starting with the hook and the jab, for over a year and a half before they even start fighting with one another. We're teaching our kids how to fight over gender and pronouns. They're teaching their kids to fight for real. We have always said the one thing that separated us and the one thing that made us impossible to invade was the fact that, you know, according to, and this is quoted to the emperor, attributed to the emperor, but I think it was actually one of his admirals of Japan, who said that, you know, no one dares invade the U.S. because there's a gun behind every blade of grass. This used to be true. It is not true anymore. We used to teach people how to use firearms because we understood that there comes a time when we may be our own last line of defense, because we grew up learning not to depend on the government. because that's how we were raised. And now we have an entire generation who is not only dependent upon, but beholden to the government, and they're just now starting to shake some of that off. The problem is they're shaking it off in the wrong direction, because they don't want to be beholden to a capitalist government anymore. They would much rather be beholden to a communist government and have everything handed to them that they feel they're ever going to need, not realizing that a vast majority of them will be trampled underfoot and discarded when no longer useful, because they're not being told the truth about what communism and socialism actually is. It's being presented as this shiny red apple of how everybody's needs are met, everybody's needs are met according to the many, and that's just how it works. But they don't realize that when you bite into that apple, it's rotten. Are there issues with capitalism? Yes. Can it become an oligarchy very easily? Yes, I submit that we're living in one right now. But the difference between capitalism and communism is you could eventually wake up and start fighting your own way out of the paper bag with capitalism, because you have mechanisms in place that you can figure out how to use the system. And the system exists for a reason, folks. Don't let anybody ever tell you that it doesn't. The problem is we have all the people at the top that make all the rules that already understand how the system works. Those of us at the bottom have no idea how most of it works, and therefore we spend our lives doing what we thought we were supposed to do, getting decent paying jobs, raising a family, taking care of our house, our car, our day-to-day needs, and then expecting the government to be there to bail us out at retirement time, instead of taking our own steps to make sure that we don't have to retire at 65, we don't have to retire at 70, we don't have to retire at 75, we can actually retire earlier. But it's the things that aren't being taught anymore, and they don't teach them on purpose. They don't want our little boys learning how to fight, because that's toxic masculinity. China doesn't understand the term toxic masculinity, they just laugh at it. Russia doesn't understand the term toxic masculinity, they just laugh at it. Because they are teaching their children from birth to fight. Now, you can either like that assessment, you can disagree with it, I don't really care which tack you decide to take, but the truth of it is, folks, these people are starting to kick our asses. And I am very, very sad to have to say that. Lucky for us, Russia and China's economies are in even worse shape than ours. But I don't know how much longer that's going to be the case. So we have to decide. Much like Ronald Reagan's speech, are we going to remain the city on the hill, or are we going to fall into darkness? Because we're dangerously close to falling into darkness. This bill that is being touted by so many will help finish us off, and nobody's talking about that part of it. Because, folks, I get it. Everybody's, well, that's not actually what it says. No, what it actually says is there has to be a peak of like over 8,000 within a given day, or a rolling tally total of 5,000 per day for a week for the border protections to kick in automatically and for the border to be sealed. But then again, there's another subsection in there that explains that all that really does is stop them from being able to come across the border in the non-port sections, in the areas that aren't designated for entry. And it restricts them to coming through the entry ports. That should be a given already, because to do so otherwise is a felony. We need to start enforcing that again. And it's pretty easy, because when you're charged with a felony, last I checked, legally you were automatically eligible for deportation. They don't even have to go through our criminal justice system and been found guilty of a felony to be deported. Because what trial do you actually need? You have a border agent who caught them illegally crossing the border. That's automatic deportation. It has been for a long time. It should have been this entire time. And we need to get back to that. We could fix all of this without a single additional piece of legislation, because all of the tools are already there. So for everybody, including James Lankford, who is trying to spin this as the best thing ever, please just wake up. Look, read it for yourself. I get it. It's legalese. It's confusing. It's painful. I do this stuff for a living, and it hurts my head to read this stuff. But you need to do it, because you have to understand what it is that they're trying to do. And if you can, if you're trying to read it and you don't understand it, reach out to somebody that does understand these kind of things, so you can look at what they're actually trying to do. Stop taking everybody's word for it. Because then you're going to know the truth. And ladies and gentlemen, the truth will set you free. The truth is, this government doesn't give one ounce of care for me, you, or anybody else that's already here. Because we're already plugged into the system. We're already part of the battery. They need new batteries. Been talking about this for weeks. 1913 was the beginning of the end of this country, and the Republicans were duped into making it happen because they were actually of the mind that anybody who understood what was going on would not ratify an amendment to make income tax constitutional because they would not be willing to just basically hand over their money to the government. It passed with 75% consent, which made it an amendment. That was the day we started working for them, not they working for us. And it's been that way ever since, and it's gotten worse. So everybody talks about, and I know I've talked about this a lot, but I'm going to keep talking about it because I feel like nobody's hearing me. That everybody talks about how the Matrix is this whole, you know, grand global warming conspiracy, blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. Human beings are locusts. The AI wants to wipe us out, which that part of it is true. That's the basic premise of the movie. What if I told you that it kind of goes a little further if you know where to look? This is actually a basically a warning and a clarion call that we are already part of the Matrix, and not in the way that you might think. You know, at some point we may learn that we are all part of some virtual reality program, because that has been theorized. But this is where I'm going with it. As soon as they started being able to tap into your money without your consent and just take it from you, you became the battery feeding the very thing that a lot of us are fighting against. That's the part that I need you to understand. How do you fight it when you're not part of it? How do you fight it when you're the one feeding it? As painful as this is to talk about, I feel like we need to talk about it because, I mean, literally, we are feeding the machine that we hate. All right, well, we are back around to the top of the hour break. I'm Rick Robinson. This is my show. We'll be back before you know it, so stay tuned. Hour two coming at you on the other side.
Turn my collar to the cold and damp. When my eyes were stabbed by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Hi, everyone. This is JJ, the co-founder of Good Pods.
If you haven't heard of it yet, Good Pods is like Goodreads or Instagram, but for podcasts. It's new, it's social, it's different, and it's growing really fast. There are more than 2 million podcasts, and we know that it is impossible to figure out what to listen to. On Good Pods, you follow your friends and podcasters to see what they like. That is the number one way to discover new shows and episodes. You can find Good Pods on the web or download the app. Happy listening.
In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the healthcare coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a mutual legal reserve company. In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the healthcare coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a mutual legal reserve company.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 of pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
Mm-hmm.
back into the program. Ladies and gentlemen, hour two of the Monday edition of the Rick Robinson Show coming at you live. And for those of you that have been hanging out for a while, you may remember that we just did the State of the State address here in Oklahoma, covered that in its entirety. May or may not do a write-up about that later today on my Substack. If not today, maybe tomorrow. Because I still feel like I'm playing catch-up and it's only Monday. It just started and I already feel like I'm behind. But anyway, so we're back. We're live, and there's much, much more to talk about. First things first, this is from our friends at The Blaze, who have jumped the shark a little bit lately, but still are right more often than they're wrong. Lankford's compromise border bill legalizes the invasion. This is written by Daniel Horowitz, Dateline Today. The legislation waters down existing immigration law and provides the president with the toothless emergency powers, all while lavishing billions more tax dollars on Ukraine. You've got to hand it to Senator James Lankford, Republican Oklahoma, and Mitch McConnell's other lieutenants in the Senate. They really did manage to solve the illegal immigration crisis. They're simply going to make the invasion legal. In exchange for us agreeing to an endless flow of illegal immigrants across the southern border, Democrats will get another $60 billion for Ukraine. Some call that bipartisanship, but we call it disenfranchisement of the forgotten American who is always placed last in the ultimate abrogation of the social compact. The truth of it is, though, folks, we have nobody to blame but ourselves. This invasion will continue, and the GOP treachery will accelerate, until we finally get serious about where we are. As the article continues, to understand the essential treachery of Lankford's immigration deal, we must acknowledge that no one is allowed to crash our border under current law. In 2006, a supermajority of Congress passed the Secure Fence Act. It required the Secretary of Homeland Security to take all actions necessary within 18 months of passage to achieve and maintain operational control over the entire international land and maritime borders of the United States. Anybody want to, and this is me, not them. Does anybody remember why we did those things? It was 2006. That was 5 years after 9/11. How quickly we forget how important our security became when people came into our country illegally and did heinous things to us. That wasn't that long ago. It was, what, 23 years? I know for some people that's a long time. For me, it feels like tomorrow or yesterday. The bill defined operational control as the prevention of all unlawful entries into the United States, including entries by terrorists, other unlawful aliens, instruments of terrorism, narcotics, and other contraband. In short, the law demands that the Biden administration stop all invaders. Instead, the government works with the cartels to orchestrate a constant flow and has gone out of its way to subvert the efforts of Texas to secure its own border. Lankford's bill would allow the Biden administration to reap the benefits of its own crime, vitiating current law and bringing in millions of illegal aliens. The bill would essentially allow up to 5,000 illegal aliens per day to enter the country. It explicitly grants the Homeland Security Secretary authorization to provide them with work permits. In fact, page 41 of the bill stipulates that if the alien receives a positive protection determination, the alien shall be issued employment authorization. Here are some of the bill's other key provisions. The authority to shut off the flow after 5,000 invaders per day is countermanded by the discretionary authority, according to Biden, to suspend any emergency declaration. Page 27 of the bill maintains that those seeking asylum shall be released from physical custody. This destroys current law, which directs, in the case of an alien who is an applicant for admission, if the examining immigration officer determines that an alien seeking admission is not clearly and beyond a doubt entitled to be admitted, the alien shall be detained for a removal proceeding. The bill also would give full discretionary authority to immigration officials to detain all those presumed to be in the country illegally, pending a decision on whether the alien is to be removed. In addition to weakening asylum laws by mandating that anyone with intent to declare asylum be released and given work authorization in 6 months, the bill would also allow the DHS secretary to grant parole to anyone with an urgent humanitarian reason. The bill grants $1.29 billion for alternatives to detention, which would amount to a handout to the NGOs engaged in smuggling to continue harboring, facilitating the invasion. Further, turning border agents into babysitters rather than law enforcement, the bill would mandate training for the non-lethal use of force and de-escalation strategies and methods. To the extent states or citizens could ever challenge Biden's liberal asylum determinations made under this bill, all claims would be routed to the D.C. Circuit. That's the part I couldn't find earlier that I read through it. I was like, you've got to be kidding me. So if this, we need to slow down for a minute. Because if this passes, if this becomes law, I need you to pay attention to what I just said. To the extent states or citizens could ever challenge Biden's liberal asylum determinations made under this bill, all claims would be routed to the D.C. Circuit, which is about as liberal as the Ninth Circuit. This is clearly designed to take these cases away from the Texas-based Fifth Circuit. The bill would give the Office of Refugee Resettlement another $2.3 billion to further empower unscrupulous NGOs to colonize our communities. I like how they use the word colonize, because I've been screaming that for a while. These people are not coming here to assimilate. They're coming here to colonize, and we need to start recognizing the difference. Page 149 of the bill codifies the Flores Agreement, which incentivizes illegal aliens to traffic their kids over the border, knowing that they must be released because the DHS lacks the facilities mandated for them under the 1997 lawsuit settlement. This has been a big incentive for the invasion, not just under Biden, but also under Trump in 2018 and 2019. For reasons only Allah knows, while we are dealing with the border flow, Lankford's bill would invite in another 50,000 people on green cards. It would also expand worker visa programs and bring in even more Afghan refugees on top of the 100,000 Biden already admitted. Any good in this bill is worthless because Lankford's compromise undermines existing law, which every Democrat since Bill Clinton has been ignoring anyway. What's more, the new emergency powers the bill would enact are set to expire 270 days after the law takes effect. This effectively bars the next president from using anything good in the law while being hamstrung by the law's bad provisions. So, okay. Again, we have to slow down because this is something that even I missed. But it's very telling because this already pretty much lets you know that the foregone conclusion is Biden's on the way out the door. Any good in this bill is worthless because Lankford's compromise undermines existing law, which every Democrat since Bill Clinton has been ignoring anyway. What's more, the new emergency powers the bill would enact are set to expire 270 days after the law takes effect. That effectively bars the next president from using anything good in the law while being hamstrung by the law's bad provisions. So the bill concedes the border to the left's priorities and bequeaths the Democrats $60 billion in additional funding for Ukraine, including $300 million for the Ukrainian police. It also includes $10 billion for Hamas, or, as they say, Gaza humanitarian aid. Undoubtedly, Lankford's bill will be dead on arrival in the House. Nevertheless, it stands as a testament to the treachery that runs wide and deep among numerous red state Republican senators. It also underscores the fecklessness of the conservative movement in vetting candidates in states like Oklahoma. No matter what Lankford does, no matter how many principles he betrays, he will continue to enjoy establishment support. I warned against Lankford's ascendancy from the House to the Senate when Tom Coburn resigned 10 years ago and was quoted in The Hill as a more conservative House member to run. And this is actually his quote from 2014. Conservatives can do better than Lankford for Senate in Oklahoma. And I agreed with him, which is why I didn't vote for Lankford. Didn't do me any good, though. Unfortunately, the entire party circled wagons around Lankford, and few others raised concerns, thereby clearing the field for him. I then warned that he was working on amnesty throughout his first term. Again, this is from Mr. Horowitz's Twitter account. Lankford thinks that religious activism is now all about refugees, open borders, and jailbreak. Well, we already have Soros for that. How long is this clip? I'm curious. See if it'll play. Well, it might play eventually.
One area that you have been working on with colleagues across the aisle, I understand, is immigration. Right. And there has been a very difficult debate going on in the House of Representatives, something of a revolt among more moderate Republicans and, you know, even conservative Republicans who think that there should be a solution for the DACA kids. Are you working on anything here in the Senate to try to address this problem before the end of the year?
I am. There's a group of us that are meeting quietly to try to see if we can find common ground. At the end of February, it was no grand secret there was an epic failure of the Senate to be able to pass any one of four bills that were put forward. All four of them had bipartisan support from different individuals in different amounts, but all four of them had bipartisan support. Typically, you'd have the four bills come up, they would all fail, and then the next week, you would try to blend those four together into one and to get it done. What happened instead was the court stepped in and said that they're going to put a hold on all the process and nothing can change on DACA until they make a decision. And so the Senate just walked away.
It took the pressure off.
That's right. The pressure was off. There was no timeline anymore. Well, I think there still is a timeline. We just don't know what the date is. At some point, the court's going to rule, and I think the court will rule in the president's favor, not because I'm a Republican, but because I believe that one executive can change the actions of a previous executive, just like a future president can change the actions of President Trump if it's an executive order. That's just basic governance.
Do you think that whatever you're working on will have to include a path to citizenship for Dreamers?
I do. I've been pretty outspoken on that for even the last.
Womp, womp, womp. This is why he hasn't gotten my vote a single time. Anyway, there's more.
September, Senator Tillis and I both put out a proposal to get citizenship for those individuals that are in the DACA program or were eligible for the DACA program, because we've got a group that was in the DACA program, but we've got a group that never signed up, never went through the paperwork for whatever reason, never eligible for it. We'd like those individuals to be able to have access to citizenship as well. Now, we've got to deal with border security. There are reasonable ways to be able to do that that have been talked about for a long time.
The wall? Would you give the president his wall in this?
I would, because most of the areas, it's not really a wall.
Oh, so keep in mind, this is from 2018, and this was an interview that Senator James Langford did on MSNBC, talking about how there had to be a path for citizenship for the DACA kids. Did there really, though? Does there really need to be one? I disagree. Which is yet another reason why I haven't voted for this man one time in the time frames that I've been able to vote for him. I can't say that to be completely true. I did vote for him the first time he ran for the House. I did not any subsequent times, and I also have never voted for him to become a senator. He does have the ear of a lot of folks around here, and because he knows I don't like him, even though invitations have been extended, he has not done any of the shows that I've been on, whether they've been podcast or terrestrial, because he knows I don't like him. But I do like to try to give people the opportunity to explain themselves. The problem that I have is everything that he's saying to explain himself is wrong. Sadly, despite years of treachery, this is back to the article again, Langford was reelected in 2022 with 64% of the vote. I was among that 36, just saying. Why was there no market for a primary challenger? Because Donald Trump gave him a gratuitously Orwellian endorsement, referring to him as strong on the border and tough on crime, when the opposite is true on both accounts. We have nobody to blame but ourselves. The invasion will continue and GOP treachery will accelerate until we get serious and focus on the primaries slated to begin next month. What was the dateline on this? Pretty sure this was... Bubba, primaries have already started. Anyway, so yeah, there you have even more of the craziness of this bill, which James Langford is still busily defending. Can't make this up. Well, it doesn't matter. Sorry, I was reading something that was reposted by Senator Langford from, looks like Bill Malusion. Breaking in a statement to Fox News, The Border Patrol Union says that it supports and endorses the bipartisan border deal negotiated in the Senate, saying it's not perfect, but it's better than the status quo. They do, however, not endorse the rest of the spending bill. So, who cares? Because, yeah. Okay, this is part of what annoys me. I want you guys to hear this from him. Hang on, let me get it queued up.
Joining us now for his first interview since the text was released last night, GOP Senator James Lankford. Senator, thanks so much for joining us. I'm going to go to the part that you wanted to find the most misunderstood, the 5,000. What is it exactly?
Yeah, it's really ridiculous when we go on the backside of December, what just happened when we had 10 and 12,000 people a day coming across. And this authority is a 5,000 authority to say if you get to 5,000, which we've been there every single day except for 7 in the last 4 months, that it completely closes the border down. It deports everyone. It changes the paradigm from right now what the Biden administration is doing is catching and releasing everyone to actually catching and deporting everyone. It literally flips the script on it. I have people saying, well, I don't want to do that at 5,000. I want to do that at 3,000. Say, well, fine, we can do 3,000. But right now, every day we're at 5,000. It doesn't matter between the two. We've got to be able to have something that mandatorily deports everyone rather than actually releases everyone. That's what this does. Some people are thinking that this is somehow like counting 5,000 people in every day and releasing them. That's absurd. We changed the asylum laws. We increased detention beds. We doubled the deportation flights. We add ankle monitors for people that
this
are.
This is the same thing he says every time, by the way.
So we can track any individual that when we don't have capacity, right. There's all the things that we build into this to make this a much stronger system. Gaps that are in the law get closed in this structure.
So, all right. So let me break this down again, because this is the same thing that I've heard him say here locally. Every time I've heard him give an interview on this, he basically uses these same several talking points. So let me break down to you exactly how this is going to work. Yes, he's right. If this was to pass right now, it would likely lock our border down immediately. But let me tell you what the government would start. Well, assuming Joe Biden decided to follow those laws in the first place. But let me explain to you what would happen. They would then start working out deals with the cartels and everybody else that they've been using to facilitate these things. And yes, they have been doing that, whether anybody wants to tell you they have or not. It's still the truth. Our government is just as involved in getting these people here as the rest of the governments are that have been helping them. That's part of the reason why Mexico just kind of rolled its eyes at Biden over and over again when he started screaming for their help. Because everybody knows that our government is in bed with all these people. But so even if what Lankford says right now is true, again, keep in mind that yes, it would if Biden actually followed the new laws. Lock down the border, but it doesn't completely lock down the border. It just moves them to being able to be, they have to come in through actual legal means and then be vetted. Then the other thing to keep in mind is all that would do is they would send out notifications to all these charities and everybody that's helping, because he's right, there won't be a little clicker at the border, but there'll be a little clicker at all the charities. All right, this is 4,999. You guys are going to be going through. You guys will be here by this date. You'll count towards those numbers. And then, okay, you're the next group. We'll have you there the following day. And again, you're the last one that's going to be allowed to go through. And that's exactly what's going to happen. If you don't believe me, pass it. Let them pass it and watch what happens. But if you let them pass it, that's it. We're done. This country is already teetering on the brink. If we fall for this crap, it's over. Because that's exactly what they're going to do. And if you don't believe me, it's what they've done every other time. They have started working within the constraints of the new laws to make sure that they are not necessarily violating them on the face of the law, except for the part that, you know, is a federal crime and a felony to cross our border illegally. So that is already grounds for the president to close our border. Which, again, just trying to make sure people understand. Anyway. Sorry, I got distracted. He's kind of being taken apart on his thread. which couldn't happen to a nicer dude. Just saying. So here he goes again, trying to defend it. The Biden Emergency Authority has been the most misunderstood or maybe just misrepresented parts of the bill. Some people have said it would mean 5,000 people a day are coming into the country every day. That is absurd and untrue. No, it's actually not. The Emergency Authority is not designed to let 5,000 people in. It is designed to close the border and turn 5,000 people around. What about 4,999, sir? The Border Emergency Authority last 3 years to force this administration to shut down the border and to give time for the next POTUS to hire more agents and more officers. After 3 years, the Emergency Authority expires because we should have regained full control of our border by then. 270 days is not 3 years, my dude. Our immigration laws have been weak for years. This is a once-in-a-generation opportunity to stop the chaos and protect our nation. Our border laws are not weak. The people enforcing them are. It is a felony to cross our border illegally. What part of that is weak? Please explain to me what part of it being a felony to cross our border. Anyway. Alright, so just to see if I'm right, because this is from February 2nd, so this is actually even before the bill came out. Let's see if he uses the same talking points, shall we? Because I'm pretty sure he does, because it's almost the same exact length of time, too.
Yeah, it's not, again, it's not gates opening. That's a misunderstanding of the bill itself. It's how many can we process and actually deport. When you raise the standard for people coming across, when you increase the detention beds, when you increase deportation flights, you're not letting people in. And people are thinking about how the Biden administration is running it now. Right now, the Biden administration is allowing, for instance, 1,500 people a day just to come to the ports of entry, get a work permit, and get released in the country. People coming between ports of entry get what's called a notice to appear and get released in the country. All of that stops. We're focused on how many people can we process quickly and then deport out of the country, not release into the country. It would be absolutely absurd for anyone to be able to propose something to say we're just going to slow the number of releases. We're focused on how do we actually enforce our border and get us back to zero people actually crossing the border illegally. Every administration has struggled to be able to get the authorities in place to be able to actually enforce our border. Let's put them in place.
The problem, my dude, is that may be what you're telling everybody the bill says. That ain't what the bill says. We're reading it for ourselves now, dude. You can stop lying now. Just saying. You can stop lying now. It'll be all right, I promise. Maybe. All right, well, we skipped one break, and it's definitely time to take one, because we're at bottom of the hour. So let's do that now, shall we? I had a song in mind. There it is. Let's go to break with some Queen, shall we? You are listening to The Rick Robinson Show live right here on KLRNradio.com. We are America's Podcast Network, back for the final segment of the show on the other side of the break. Stay tuned.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Hi, everyone. This is JJ, the co-founder of Good Pods. If you haven't heard of it yet, Good Pods is like Goodreads or Instagram, but for podcasts. It's new, it's social, it's different, and it's growing really fast. There are more than 2 million podcasts, and we know that it is impossible to figure out what to listen to. On Good Pods, you follow your friends and podcasters to see what they like. That is the number one way to discover new shows and episodes. You can find Good Pods on the web or download the app. Happy listening.
In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the healthcare coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a mutual legal reserve company. In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the healthcare coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a mutual legal reserve company.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now, 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
And welcome back into the program, ladies and gentlemen. Final segment of the Monday edition of the Rick Robinson Show coming at you live. Couple more quick hits on the way out the door. So first things first, everybody remember the Nuttty Professor? Yeah, the chick that was, you know, fired from her job and arrested for trying to come after a student with a machete. Well, apparently she was rehired, and she has been fired again for an anti-Israel screed on social media. And I quote, "This is fascism. Y'all are witnessing fascism in real time, and nobody's doing anything about it, all because they don't like what I'm saying." Apparently, she got a job teaching something art-related at this most recent school, so of course, she had to throw that in there. The whole purpose of being an artist is to hold up a mirror and show the world what they see. What we see is a crazy chick, so we can stop looking now. Please and thank you. All right, so as promised, the House, once the bill came out, they weren't from the Senate. They weren't happy. This is from Katie Pavlich. House leadership goes scorched earth on Senate border bill. U.S. House leadership, including Speaker Mike Johnson, Majority Leader Steve Scalise, Majority Whip Tom Emmer, and Conference Chair Elise Stefanik, released a joint statement Monday, blasting the Senate's Border Act, reiterating the legislation is going nowhere if it happens to get out of the upper chamber. Here is the statement in full. And this, of course, is from our friends over at Town Hall. House Republicans oppose the Senate immigration bill because it fails in every policy area needed to secure our border and would actually incentivize more illegal immigration. Among its many flaws, the bill expands work authorizations for illegal aliens. I'm pretty sure Lankford just said it didn't do that, but we've read through it and we see that it does, so let's keep going. For illegal aliens, while failing to include critical asylum reforms. Even worse, its language allowing illegals to be released from physical custody would effectively endorse the Biden catch-and-release policy. The so-called shutdown authority in the bill is anything but, riddled with loopholes that grant far too much discretionary authority to Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas, who has proven he will exploit every measure possible in defiance of the law to keep the border open. The bill also fails to adequately stop the president's abuse of parole authority and provides for taxpayer funds to fly and house illegal immigrants in hotels through the FEMA Shelter and Services Program. Because President Biden has refused to utilize his broad executive authority to end the border catastrophe that he has created, the House led 9 months ago with the passage of the Secure the Border Act, H.R. 2. That bill contains the necessary components to actually stem the flow of illegals and end the present crisis. The Senate must take it up immediately. So, American sovereignty is at stake. Any consideration of the Senate bill in its current form is a waste of time. It is dead on arrival in the House. We encourage the U.S. Senate to reject it. Meanwhile, Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, Republican Senator James Lankford, and President Joe Biden are urging yes votes on the bill. Anyway, yay. So yes, the border's out of control. Apparently, the two branches of our legislative government have differing, or the two chambers of our legislative government have different ideas on how we're supposed to fix it. So here's another little quick hit on the way out. Anybody remember Circleback's hockey? Man, I miss having her as the press sec. At least she could lie well, unlike this newer one. But apparently, her ability to lie isn't helping her much. This is from Rebecca Downs, also a town hall. Jen Psaki, as I call her, isn't doing so well in her expanded time slot. Last year, it was announced that former White House press sec turned MSNBC host Jen Psaki was going to be getting an expanded time slot, with her show airing not just on Sundays, but on Monday nights during the 8 p.m. primetime slot as well. As our sister site of Twitchy highlighted, it was hardly a shocking move. It turns out that Psaki isn't doing too well, though. Inside with Jen... That title's just wrong. Inside with Jen Psaki currently airs on Sundays, and now since September 25th, also on Monday at 8 p.m. Chris Hayes had that primetime slot from Tuesday through... Or Chris Hayes has that time slot... Primetime slot, wow, from Tuesday to Friday. According to Nielsen Media Research, for the last quarter that just passed, Psaki is down 10% in that coveted 25 to 54 advertising demo, while total viewership is at a decline of 4%. She averages just 133,000 viewers in the demo. Psaki is doing so poorly, in fact, that she's losing to CNN with Anderson Cooper, faring better on Monday in his 8 p.m. time slot. Her show also loses to repeat episodes of Seinfeld, Law and Order, and Rick and Morty. On Sunday, on the Sunday edition of Inside with Jen Psaki, which airs at 12 p.m., delivers just 75,000 viewers in the coveted demo, and is even beaten out by repeats of Golden Girls and Roseanne on TV Land. And Psaki has indeed been... granting helpful coverage to the Biden re-election campaign, just as she did last month. She's also gone after Republicans in incredibly eye-roll-inducing ways, just as you would expect, such as Speaker Mike Johnson, Republican Louisiana, when he had just taken the gavel. That's all, of course, in addition to her going after former and potentially future President Donald Trump on a regular basis, who is likely to be President Joe Biden's opponent once more come the November election. It doesn't look like the American people are buying what Psaki and her network and the liberal mainstream media outlets are selling. Expect her to get all the more desperate. We are in an election year, after all. That his former press sec has such poor viewership in a key demo is just one of many issues further facing Biden, as he insists he's still running for re-election. It's not just Psaki who's doing poorly. The polls show bad news for Biden as well, especially the NBC News latest poll. Real Clear polling currently has Trump with a lead over Biden of 2.1%, and Biden with an approval rating of just 40.2%, while 55% disapprove. So just for fun, let's pull up the latest poll from NBC. Polled, 20-point deficit on handling of economy highlights Biden's struggle against Trump. The president's approval rating has fallen to a new low in NBC's new polling as Trump narrowly leads in a 2024 general election matchup. Despite a growing economy and little opposition for his party's nomination, President Joe Biden confronts a dissatisfied electorate and a challenging political climate 9 months before he faces re-election, according to a new national NBC News poll. Biden trails GOP presidential frontrunner Donald Trump on a major policy and personal comparison, including by more than 20 points on which candidate would be able to better handle the economy. Joe Biden's deficit versus Trump on handling immigration and the border is greater than 30%. The poll also shows Trump holding a 16-point advantage over Biden on being competent and effective, a reversal from 2020 when Biden was ahead of Trump on this quality by 9 points before defeating him in that election. And Biden's approval rating has declined to the lowest level of his presidency. In NBC News polling, to a 37%, while fewer than 3 in 10 voters approve of his handling of the Israel-Hamas war. Altogether, these numbers explain why the poll shows Trump leading Biden by 5 points among registered voters in a hypothetical 2024 general election matchup, 47% to 42. While the result is within the poll's margin of error, the last year of polling shows a clear shift. And they're right, because over the last year, Trump is just gaining point after point after point in all the polls. Now, polling doesn't mean crap. So this is what I'm about to say to all of you guys. Don't get complacent. Look, I understand that a lot of us don't like Trump's COVID policies. And I am not anybody who is refusing to vote for him, especially if you have loved ones that you've either lost or have been impacted by his COVID policies. I'm not screaming at you. I would never do that. But for those of you that just don't like him because he's evil, or because you've bought all the crap that the mainstream media is selling, or because you've listened to him and he sounds like an asshole, I would much rather be led by an asshole who keeps us out of wars than an asshole who puts us in war after war after war. Because Joe Biden is just as big of an asshole. The difference is he's up until now had a better filter about it. Donald Trump really doesn't. So you have an asshole who's killing us, or you have an asshole who at least wants to, at least on paper, put America first again. Doesn't really seem like much of a choice to me. So, just to make sure we're on the same page, again, remember, this is month after month after month. These are the polls from, looks like, July of 23 had Biden edging out Trump by 3 points. September of 23, Biden and Trump were in a statistical dead heat. November of 23, Biden was at 44%, Trump was at 46%. January of 23, which is the most recent poll, 42 to 47. The interesting thing is, the margin of error keeps shifting. So these people are trying, this is the part that I'm trying to make everybody understand. These people keep trying to poll more people to bring these numbers back down, and it's not working. Because each poll has a different margin of error. This one was all the way up to plus or minus 5. I don't remember the last time I saw a poll with plus or minus 5. So what that tells me is they are doing everything they can to try to swing the vote the way that they need it to be. But as we get ready to leave for the day, another little interesting thing to point out, because the Democrats held their first official primary on Saturday. Yes, I said Saturday. In South Carolina, and while President Biden did win quite handily, there's something the media is not telling you. They had a 4% turnout. 4%. Now, I need you to understand this, because that's what everybody's been saying about, well, that's the whole reason Donald Trump won Ohio, and it's the whole reason. The whole reason that he won the primary in New Hampshire is because of low turnout. Our turnout isn't where we expected it to be, but so far it's like 3-4 times higher than Biden's turnout. Is that going to hold? Is it going to matter? Only time will tell. But here we are. So, yes, Joe Biden apparently won with like 97% of the vote. Nobody was really surprised. What everybody was surprised about is, holy crap, only 4% of the entire state came out to vote at all, which means 96% of South Carolina stayed home. You want to tell me again that people are satisfied with Joe Biden? Let me show you how dissatisfied everybody is.
One half of the immigration equation.
Hang on. That's not the one I was trying to play. Hang on. Played this one last night. Gonna play it again as we get ready to leave, though.
Same position. I'm not even mad at you, baby. I'm feeling like fake news. This is the thing. I know people don't like Trump. I understand that. But let me tell you something. If I had to pick between him and Joe Biden, I'm not voting in Joe Biden. You want to see a bunch of black people go to jail by the next 4 years? Put Joe Biden. Watch what happens. You want to see black men get killed substantially? Like you've never seen before, put Joe Biden in and watch what happens. These Democrats, and I'm sorry to say this, I'm not trying to be racist, but they hate black people. These are the same people who have been fought to keep slavery in. These are the same people who built the KKK. These are the same people who hated us from the beginning. The Republican Party is the party of the blacks. Blacks free, the Republican Party is the only party that the black people actually assisted in finding. But all of that history has been torn away. People say, oh, there was this big switch. There was never a big switch. The union won because we had grown in the industrial era. So we were able to get trains and get supplies back to our soldiers while the Confederate was still riding horses. They were not able to get supplies back fast enough, right? So what happened was once slavery was abolished in the South, the people in the South could no longer make their money from slaves. They had to move to the North to work in the industry to produce. And so the people in the North that already had established themselves in the industry moved to the South. And so that's where it was a transfer of people coming from the South to the North and people coming from the North to the South. There was never a big switch. So the same Democrats who hated black people from the beginning are the same ones who hate us now. And they use our cause. How did Black Lives Matter turn into something about LGBTQ when blacks really don't support that? We're conservative. We're really not about that. Not only that, we don't support abortion. We're about workers. This is the black culture. We ain't never been about that. Not only that, we're not about feminism.
No, we're not.
Black women marry their husbands and respect their husbands. That's what we on. We're not on this. Oh, I do what I want. We don't do that. That's not our community, and you would understand. I know you understand what I'm saying. We don't do that. But yet these people are hijacking our movement, and the Democratic Party, they're trying to hijack our stuff. No.
So in case you couldn't tell, that was actually a woman of color letting a person on the street reporter kind of have it that went out on TikTok. Basically explaining that, you know, despite what everyone's been told, there was no party switch, that she herself understands that the same Democrats who hated her back or would have hated her back then are the same ones that hate her today. And again, this is what me, as somebody that's been trying to do this for the last 16 years, has been hoping for, is for people to finally start waking up and seeing the truth, whatever that truth is. Because the simple fact of the matter is, folks, neither party is looking out for you. One party is more interested in freedom than the other, to a smaller degree, but neither party is actually looking out for you. But it is important to note that the Democrats have been using both Hispanic voters and black voters for decades, and doing everything they could to keep them on the plantation, so to speak. And it is nice to see that so many Hispanics and black voters are starting to wake up. And that is going to be the interesting thing for me watching this develop in November, because the simple fact of the matter is, I think there's another reason why the Democrats are so gung-ho on trying to keep the border open while giving it the disguise that they've tried to put a Band-Aid on it. They're trying to replace their voter base because they realize they're losing their voter base. The only voter base they're never really going to lose is a suburban white woman. Because for some reason, they have full-on bought onto the guilt bullshit. Lock, stock, barrel, all of it. They have just bought into it completely. And I really don't understand why or how. But still and yet, here we are. And they've bought into all of it. And, you know, it is just what it is. I mean, you know, we've had female panelists and female guests on this show and other shows on KLRN that have basically said, at this point, they're even okay with just completely repealing the 19th Amendment till we fix shit. That was women. Not men pretending to be women. Not men speaking out of our asses. Those were actual women. And more than one have come on and said, look, at this point, I think the 19th Amendment needs to go away. And I would like to say that I disagree with them. I think we do have another option. I think the first thing we need to do is repeal the 17th Amendment and let the states start picking their senators again. Because we wouldn't have wound up with James Langford, I do not believe, if that were the case. I could be wrong, because he's pretty well known in this state, and believed to be staunchly conservative. I'm hoping that mask is slipping off now. All right, speaking of slipping off, it's just about that time, so it's about time for me to get out of here for the day. Don't forget, I'll be back tomorrow afternoon doing the very same thing. Rick Robinson's show, 3 to 5, then tomorrow night I'll be producing for the Cocktail Lounge with Brad and Aggie. And we do have election coverage coming up later this month, still getting the calendar built up for those things. I think Nevada primary and caucus, we're basically going to leave that one alone, because Haley's running in the primary and Trump's running in the caucus, and they've already determined that only the caucus is going to be able to get delegate votes anyway. So South Carolina will be the next one that we cover, which I believe is later this month. I think it's somewhere around February 24th for Republicans. So we'll be covering that one. And then March 5th, I believe, is Super Tuesday. And then March 7th is the State of the Union. So we have lots of political stuff coming soon. We'll try to keep you as informed and entertained as we can along the way as we get ready for November 2024 and what looks to be the geriatric rematch of the century. Again, I'm Rick Robinson. You can find me most days here on KLR Radio doing the afternoon show and then producing for other folks behind the scenes. You can also find me on Wednesday nights doing both the Whatever Show and the Rick and Morty Show, one at 7 p.m. Eastern, the other at 10 p.m. Eastern. On Thursday nights, I am part of the Jen and Rick Show, which runs at 10 p.m. Eastern. Friday nights, I've been filling in for Mickey Blowtorch, who is on hiatus doing He Said, She Said with Aggie Regan. Every other Saturday, I do Juxtaposition, our foray into conspiratainment that we do every 2 weeks. And then every Sunday, I do America Off the Rails at 10 p.m. Eastern. When I'm not doing all that, you can find me as a contributor on theLoftusParty.com, MisfitsPolitics.com, and Twitchy.com. And the Loftus Party podcast should drop sometime tomorrow. I am the executive producer of that as well. You can also find me on most social media platforms at RowdyRick73. But, ladies and gentlemen, we have reached the point where I do have to tell you this particular show is over.
What? Over? Did you say over? Nothing is over until we decide it is! Was it over when the Germans bombed Pearl Harbor? Hell no!
Closing time. Open all the doors and let you out into the world.
This isn't over until I say it's over!
Closing time.
Well, that's great.